Firstly, I would like to thank Vebleo for the kind invitation. It's my great pleasure to present our work about the nanoscale sound transport. My name is Zhang, from Institute of High Performance Computing, ASTAR, Singapore. This is my group, and today in my presentation, most of the work have been done by my group. First, I would like to share with you about the motivation. Why we started on thermal transport? The first motivation is for the temperature control. This figure shows the number of transistors on IC device. It's about double, about every 2 years. This is the year of injection, and this is the number of transistors. You can see the increase. And also at the same time, the thermal in the device is also increased, see the left. So now the computer is more and more fast, and at the same time, it becomes more and more hot. Here I show the temperature profile of the real IC device. This is from the IBM serial processor. You can see the average temperature is not very high, but there are many hot spots. The local temperature, the hot spot is small and the local temperature is high. This is also show the temperature distribution. We can see in on the chip, the average temperature is not very high, but the hot spot, the local temperature very high. And the performance of the device is imitated by the peak temperature. The hot spot will affect the reliability of the device, the performance and the cost and the lifetime. So this is why we want to study the thermal control, the thermal management of IC device, IC chip. The second motivation is for the renewable energy. As we know, more than 90% of electrical energy in the world are produced by fire power station. However, the efficiency of the fire power station is not high, only about 30 to 40%. So in the world, the total energy lost is about 15 terawatt. This is a very huge energy lost, about 30 to 100 nuclear power station. And the situation is also for car, because in the car, the efficiency is also not high, about 30 to 40%. Actually, we can use the thermal electric effect to solve the thermal problem. So in the thermal electric effect, the first one is the seatback effect. It tells us if there is a heat input through the semiconductor junction, it can generate voltage, electrical voltage. So we can use the seatback effect for heat energy harvesting. The second thermal electric effect is the Piaget effect. It describes if there is a electrical current flow through the semiconductor junction, it can absorb heat from one side and transfer to the other side. So using the Piaget effect, we can use it for the on-chip cooling for the IC thermal management. In the thermal electric effect, usually we use the eta to describe the energy conversion efficiency. Here, Zt is a figure of merit. Figure of merit Zt here, it depends on the seatback coefficient, electrical conductivity, temperature, and thermal conductivity of the materials. So for thermal electric effect, we hope to reduce the thermal conductivity to enhance the efficiency, to enhance Zt, and then enhance the efficiency eta. The advantage of the solid state technology, the thermal electric effect is remarkable. First, this is the solid state reliability, and there's no moving part, and there's no noise, no vibration part. So this is the advantage for the thermal electric cooling and for thermal electric heat energy harvesting. In the past years, there are many people, many work focused on the thermal electric effect. And we can see from 1960, now the Zt increase because we can use different ways for example, the nanotechnology to enhance the figure of metal CT. As a summary, here I show the thermal conductivity. If the material has a low thermal conductivity, we can use it for thermoelectric, for thermal production. And if the material has high thermal conductivity, we can use it for thermal management. For example, the 3DIC, flexible electronics, we can use the high thermal conductivity materials. Because this first law tells us with for the same temperature difference with high thermal conductivity, the heat current also high. So we can use the high thermal conductivity materials for thermal management. And for the low thermal conductivity materials, we use it for thermoelectric because the low thermal conductivity can result in high ZT and high efficiency. Here I show the thermal conductivity of some common materials and the graphene is here, then carbon tube and diamond. For these high thermal conductivity materials, we use them for the thermal measurement. And on the other side, for example, the silicon nanowire, if we cut silicon to very small to nanoscale nanowire, because the increased surface scattering can reduce the thermal conductivity, then we can use the nanowire for thermoelectric. Today in my talk, I focus on the high thermal conductivity part. The carbon nanotube, graphene, and is there any 2D materials can have, is there any materials can have thermal conductance higher than graphene? I will answer this question. And also the interfacial thermal conductance. So in my talk today, first I will discuss about the size dependent thermal conductivity in nanoscale materials. And then I will answer the question, can we have a 2D materials has thermal conductance even higher than graphene? The answer is both in a new 2D materials. And the third one is the interfacial thermal conductance. First, I would like to discuss about the size dependence. We use the Fourier's law to describe the thermal conductivity of materials. This is the Fourier's law. G is a heat flux, and T is a temperature. This is a temperature gradient, and kappa is thermal conductivity. Fourier's law tell us first heat flux from high temperature to low temperature. Second one is the with temperature difference increase, heat flux increase linearly, and this is the thermal conductivity. For bulk materials, thermal conductivity is a constant, independent on the size of the materials. This is the Fourier's law tell us, and in the past 200 years, we use this. We believe the thermal conductivity of a bulk materials is a constant. Constant means the thermal conductivity is independent on the size and shape of the materials. But about 20 years ago, in 2005, we found that the thermal conductivity of carbon nanotube is not a constant. It's dependent on the length. This is our work, and we use the molecular dynamic simulation to study the thermal conductivity of carbon nanotube, and we found the thermal conductivity increase with the tube length, with the power law. This is the log scale. So the linear means this is a power law. And the exponent depends on the on temperature and the diameter of the carbon nanotube. This is a 5 nanotube and this is a 10 nanotube. So for carbon nanotube, the thermal conductivity is not a constant. Thermal conductivity will increase with the length increase. This is our simulation result. And after we published the paper in 2005, and after 2 years, but on 3 years, our simulation result is verified by UC Berkeley experimental group. The Majuda and Zeta group, they did an experiment to measure the thermal conductivity of carbon nanotube. Here is the experimental platform. This is a carbon nanotube, and they can change the length of carbon nanotube, then measure the thermal conductivity. The blue curve, the 3 points, are their experimental results. And you can see here, fit very well with our simulation result. And the red one is Fourier's law, and quite different. So their experimental confirmed that 3 years ago is broke down in 1D system. So this is the conclusion. In addition to carbon nanotube in graphene is a 2D material. So there is also a strong size dependence in graphene. This is our review article in last year. In this paper, we summarized the size dependence, size effect on thermal property of different one-dimensional and two-dimensional nanomaterials. Here we can see for the graphene, with the graphene, the length increase, the thermal conductivity also increase. But the dependence is not confirmed very clear. In some simulation and results, this is just an increase, but in other results, there is a peak. So the underlying mechanism is still not unclear. But definitely the size dependence in nanoscale materials pyramid are threatened to increase the thermal conductivity and for thermal management. This tells us, for example, if you have a common nanotube for thermal management, the longer nanotube will be fine. This is a strategy for thermal management. And next, I will show you the high thermal conductance in porphyrin. The 2D materials, as we know, after the graphene, the family of 2D materials have attracted many research attention. The family of 2D materials include the graphene and phosphorine, porphyrin, and others such as the TMD, MOS2, molybdenum sulfuride, the families. And the thermal conductivity of graphene is very high, so can be used for thermal management. Usually, we believe the thermal conductivity of graphene is the highest one in the world, in nature. But we found graphene is not as high as porphyrin. Porphyrin, the thermal conductance of porphyrin is even higher than graphene. Porphyrin is the monolayer bond atoms, and it has a different structure. This is some simulation and experimental results. You can see here, these two papers are experimental results, and people can fabricate the porphyrin on different substrate. These are the different structure. And using first principle simulation with the Green's function, we studied the thermal conductance of porphyrin. We studied the thermal conductance because porphyrin has very high Debye temperature, about 2000 K. So at room temperature, the phonon transport is progressive in this system. So this is why we want to study the thermal conductance of porphyrin. And we also compare with graphene. Here, we study the temperature dependence, and we have found here, the black one is for X direction thermal conductance, and the red one is the Y direction thermal conductance. The green one is graphene. So at room temperature, the thermal conductance of porphyrin is much higher in X direction, it's much higher than graphene. And for the Y direction, it's comparable with graphene. So this phenomenon has never been observed in other 2D materials. The graphene has very high thermal conductance, but in these materials, its thermal conductance is even higher than graphene, much higher. Usually, we use the atomic mass, the number of atoms per unit area, and the interatomic stress to as the dominant factors to explain the thermal conductance. However, in these materials, in porphyrin, the atomic mass is comparable with the carbon. The number of atoms per unit area is even smaller than graphene, and the Young's modulus is also comparable with the graphene. So the high these three factors cannot explain the high thermal conductance in graphene in porphyrin, and there must be some new physics inside. To understand the high thermal conductance in porphyrin, next we study the phonon transmission to to understand the physics. And here I show the green curve is a thermal phonon transmission in graphene, and the black one is a phonon transmission in bofin along x direction, and the red one is along the y direction. We can see here in the low frequency regime, low phonon frequency regime, the transmission along x direction is similar to that along y direction. However, for high frequency phonon, quite different. In the high frequency regime, the phonon transmission along y direction is very low, but along the x direction is high. And also, this one is almost a constant. This constant phonon transmission has never been observed in other 2D materials, only observed in 1D system. The constant phonon transmission was only observed in perfect 1D channel such as carbon nanotube. So you can see here the bofin is a 2D material, but its high frequency phonon has some 1D channel, 1D behavior. This is a 2D material, and the low frequency phonon has 2D behavior, but for high frequency phonon has 1D behavior. This is quite new phenomenon. And next, we use the DLTs to study the electron density distribution and the force constant of these materials. And we can find here the electron density is looked along one direction. And for the force constant along x direction is about 30 times of that along y direction. So the bofin is a 2D material, but it can be seen as a collection of 1D chain of Bohr atoms. And this is the reason for the 1D phonon transmission behavior for high frequency phonon. So for high frequency phonon in bofin, all these phonons are transported along x direction without scattering from y direction. This is the reason for the ultra high thermal conductance in these materials. In addition to the thermal conductance, we study the effects of the atom interaction in two barrier bofin. This is the barrier bofin and some aluminum atoms interaction inside and form this structure. We call this one as the atom interaction bofin. And we compare with the intrinsic bofin, and we found very remarkable thermal conductance enhancement. Here, this is a thermal conductivity at the in-point thermal conductivity. Note the cross point. This is the in-point thermal conductivity. And we found here, this is the left is intrinsic bofin, and the right side is a bofin with atom interaction. You can see here for the zigzag direction, the enhancement is not very remarkable, but for the armchair direction, the enhancement is about 3 times. So this is a very remarkable enhancement in in-point thermal conductivity. Previously, most people studied the thermal conductivity enhancement in the Vantavirus structure, but they focus on the cross point. All of previous study only can get the enhancement in cross-point thermal conductivity, but we overwork is the first one for the in-point thermal conductivity. Next, we use the Boltzmann transfer equation and the first principle calculation to understand the phenomenon. We compare the group velocity and also the phonon reaction time. We can see here, we compare these two. The thermal, the phonon group velocity are comparable, very similar. However, for the reaction time, with the atom interaction, the reaction time increases about 10 times. So this is the unharmonicity effect induced by the atom interaction and results in the enhancement in in-point thermal conductivity. Next part, I will discuss about the interfacial thermal conductance. In the nanoscale device, with the number of interface increase, the interfacial thermal conductance is more and more important. And in some cases, the interfacial thermal resistance even dominated the thermal property of the device because the increased number of interface. In simulation part, we can use the molecular dynamic simulation to study the interfacial thermal conductance. For example, we can set the temperature, low temperature, and the other side is high temperature. Then we get the temperature profile of the system, and you can see here, there is a very large temperature jump at the interface. The temperature jump can induce the interfacial thermal resistance, and we can use this formula to calculate the interfacial thermal conductance, ITC lambda. Here G is the heat current and the delta T is the temperature jump. Previously, people, there are many works on the interfacial thermal conductance. For example, people studied the mismatched interface, the hard and soft matter materials, the interface, the junction, the interface between hard and soft materials, and even the solid liquid interface and the metal no matter interface. There are many works on different type of interface. However, in all this work, for example, we have two paths. For this interface, we have two paths, K A and B. The thermal conductivity is K kappa A and kappa B. For all these interface, if the kappa A and over kappa B the ratio increase, the interfacial thermal conductance will decrease. This is easy to understand because if we form the interface by two quite different materials, the thermal conductivity are quite different, then the interface resistance is high and the interfacial thermal conductance will reduce. So in all these materials, in all these interface, with the thermal conductivity ratio increase, the interfacial thermal conductance will decrease. This is the general phenomenon. But in last year, we found a new type of interface, totally different from this one. This is our structure. We studied the interfacial thermal conductance between the black phosphorus and the black phosphorus phononic crystal. The phononic crystal is a whole structure. There is a some hole, nanoscale hole arranged periodically. So this is a phononic crystal structure. And we found a remarkable reduction of the interfacial resistance in this system. This is the first, let's see the temperature profile. The black one is for the temperature profile in the phononic heterostructure. Left part is the phononic crystal and the other side is the intrinsic, the pristine black phosphorus. This is a heterostructure. We call it a phononic heterostructure. In this part, the left, the thermal conductivity ratio between the right and the left part is about 3/1. The thermal conductivity of these two parts are quite different, but the temperature profile is smooth and there is no temperature jump at the interface. To compare, we also studied the thermal property of the mass mismatch interface. We artificially increase the atomic mass of the phosphorus atoms at one part. So the left part is a regular BP, and on the right part, we artificially increase the atomic mass of the phosphorus atoms and get the heavy BP. So because the mass increase, the thermal conductivity will reduce, will decrease. And the thermal conductivity ratio between the left and the right part, these two parts, is also about 3/1. So for these two structures, the thermal conductivity ratio is similar. However, the temperature jump are quite different. In the phononic heterostructure, the temperature profile is smooth and the temperature jump is very small. But in the mass mismatch interface, at the mass mismatch interface, you can see here, there is a very big temperature jump at the interface. And next, we studied the interfacial thermal conductance. In the phononic mismatch BP, the the IPC is 127, very high, and in the mass mismatch in BP, the interface. Also, the thermal conductivity ratio is similar. The ITC in the physical thermal conductors is very low, only about 4. So in the phononic mismatch, the BP is 30 times of the mass mismatch of the BP. And this one is very high, comparable to the graphene and hexagonal nitride system. Next, we studied the phono dispersion to understand this phenomenon. This is the phono dispersion of the regular crystal BP, and this is a BP phononic crystal at the heavy BP. We increase the atomic mass of the phosphorus atoms. We can see here in the regular BP and compare these two. In the phononic crystal part, the phono group velocity is reduced because the band folding in the brain zone. However, because these two, the atomic mass and the interatomic force are similar. So the highest frequency of the phono is almost the same, it's comparable. As a result, the transmission of both acoustic phono and optical phono in this junction is high and results the high interfacial thermal conductance. However, in the heavy BP, the atomic mass is heavy and the phono frequency, the regime is reduced. And then the for high frequency phono in the regular BP cannot transport to the other side. This results in the very high thermal resistance. So from the phono dispersion, we can explain the phenomenon that in the BP phononic crystal, we can keep a high interfacial thermal conductance. That's it. And finally, I would like to thank my collaborators in NTU, Professor Hua Qinggao, and in ITC, Rong Wei, Hang Bo, and Ren Kai, and Rong Qing, and Dibin, and also my collaborators in China, in Donghua University, and NUS, Professor Xian Kanping, and Dr. Fu Wei. And I would like to thank the support from A-Star, and NICC, and CIC scholarship. That's all. Thanks for your attention.